Just a little bit of housekeeping. If you need the bathrooms, they're out through this door that I'm pointing at, and just follow the path along and they'll be on your right, so I'm told. Just a reminder also, please to turn your phones off or power them down or whatever you want to do, just don't leave them so they ring. Oh, hang on. Yep, all right. My name is John Beard. I'm a family friend, and it's an honor and privilege to be asked to help with this celebration of life of such a remarkable man. So it's a welcome to all of you. You all go through so many parts of Mike's life, and Mike has been such a part of your life. So it's wonderful that the family give us all this opportunity to say thank you to you all, and obviously a big thank you for everything Mike did for us. Michael John Cherry was born on September the 3rd, 1937, to Winifred and Horace Cherry in Northamptonshire. Growing up alongside his two older sisters, June and Rosemary, Mike spent his formative years at Shepherd's Hill Lodge Farm near Woolerton, a picturesque rural setting where the family tended to a bustling cereal farm and raised cattle. nearest neighbors were a mile away. So of course they walked, cycled to school. And then later on, Mike had a daily bus journey to Wellingborough Grammar School. Mike said that his time and experience on the farm with 4 to 5 working plough horses stood him in good stead later in life when he was involved with the Bermuda Equestrian Federation. Probably not too many plough horses there. And of course, Dennis's riding career. However, Mike never took up riding himself. When he left school, Mike was armed with several O-levels, but the idea of doing A-levels and college or university did not appeal to him. Instead, he applied and was accepted into the newly formed cadet scheme of the Northamptonshire County Constabulary in 1954. However, with the uncertainty of conscription, which was you had to go into the forces at the time, Mike decided to proactively enlist in the RAF for 2 years as a radar mechanic with a particular interest in Falcon bombers. This fueled his desire for travel and adventure. This included touring across the continent on his motorcycle to meet up with his sister Rosemary in Italy. His overseas exploits were featured as a picture advert in the top-selling motorcycle magazine. This was to the delight of his family, as they thought he now had a newfound career in modeling. Mike's dedication to public service led him back to the police in 1958, when he secured a job with Leicester City Police. Don't know if many of you know Leicester, but he found city life there very different to his rural upbringing. After reading an advert pinned on the station notice board, his attention was drawn to an opportunity of an overseas transfer somewhere warmer than the rainy streets of Leicester. He broke the exciting news to his family of his acceptance to the Bermuda Police Service, a place where so little was known about. Fond farewells were bid, and he arrived in Bermuda in July 1959. He started on the beat in Hamilton. He was then transferred in 1960 to Traffic and later worked in the Western Division. In 1963, he was promoted to Sergeant and was in charge of Paris Constables. It was the fastest any officer had become a Sergeant at that time. As is obvious with his children, throughout his professional life, Mike's passion for sport was evident. He was always active. He played rugby for the police team, where he captained the second 15 for several seasons. If we're very lucky, Sean will show us the rugby blazers soon. Yeah. He also took up sailing and squash and was a founding member and secretary of the Squash Rackets Association. The police took over the squash courts at Malabar, where they had many games against visiting Royal Navy ships, which again, Mike, of course, helped to organize and also play them. He kept a book of all the results of games played, which the family still have today. And then, of course, romance was in the air. On the social front, unbeknownst to both of them, Mike and Anne were set up on a blind date. There was no Tinder or dating apps or anything, which was obviously successful. On September the 7th, 1961, they were married at Selsey Rectory in Sussex, UK. Of course, one of Anne's conditions to them getting married was that Mike had to be the same age as her before she would tie the knot. The wedding date was picked specifically because it was the first Thursday after Mike's birthday when he caught up in age with Anne. They would both be 24. However, with this meticulous planning, the registrar unfortunately entered their ages as 24 and 23, so their master plan was foiled. After the wedding, the couple went on to buy a house in Daisyfield, Somerset, where they laid down roots and lived happily for 54 years, enjoying a lifelong partnership filled with love, laughter, and many shared adventures. Those of us who know Mike well knew he enjoyed a laugh, and those of you who know Annie know she loves a laugh also. So I'm sure it's a wonderful time for all. Mike and Anne became proud, loving parents of their daughter Leslie in 1964 and their son Dennis in 1966. Followed by, of course, any number of ponies, horses, dogs, cats, bunny rabbits, guinea pigs, and other furry family members. Dennis and Leslie both remember their parents being very involved and present in their childhood years. However, Mike and Anne had full-time jobs. So Leslie and Dennis spent quite a lot of time at Auntie Zita's nursery across the road from their house and building friendships with other neighborhood children in the Daisy Field Posse. Mike left the police service in 1968 and went to work in the travel industry for a short time with Air Canada and then at Watlington Conyers. He eventually became co-owner of Watlington Conyers with Russ Stober, where his lifelong friend and Daisy Field neighbour, Mike Hodgson, did the accounts and group booking. Family friend, Patty Petty, remembers a very knowledgeable Mike sitting down with her to discuss the complexities of travel, even though, of course, Patty worked for a different agency. They both served together on the Standards Committee of BOA, and Patty considered Mike to be a great mentor and go-to person. He had insight into all sports, was fair and objective to all athletes, no matter their sport. Patty would often call him at home to seek clarity on something she thought was important. She remembers they would talk it through, and more often than not, Mike, of course, was spot on. Mike and Anne also offered invaluable help to Patty and the organizers at the triathlons in the early 80s. Patty says she would truly miss their chance and their friendship that they enjoyed over many years. True story, and I'll bare my soul here, talking about Mike in the travel world. Leslie might remember this. One year I organized a football trip, as I chaotically did from time to time, to the UK, booked everything with Mike, and the week before we were due to go, I got a call from Mike. He said, "John, why aren't you and your team at the airport?" I said, "Because we don't go to next week, Mike." He said, "That's not what you booked." Mike didn't say anything. I'm sure he said a few more things to people behind my back. He changed the whole thing, and we all went the following week. And I shall never forget the fact that he shouted or screamed at me, which I would probably have done in this case, and he just calmly got on with it. And I think as we go through this more and more, that's the piece we should all remember of Mike. He just did it and was calm, cool, and collected about it. When Mike retired from active participation in rugby and squash, he got involved in the technical and public relations side of both swimming and equestrian events, obviously inheriting those interests from Leslie and Dennis. In typical Mike fashion, he did not sit quietly by. Became fully invested and engaged, offering support in many ways. He was the founding member of Harbour Amateur Swimming Club in 1974. Served on the executive committee for a number of years. He also served on the board of the Bermuda Amateur Swimming Association and was responsible for updating swim records. He was, as is obvious here today, deeply involved in the Bermuda Equestrian Federation as a member of the board. He then served as president for 20 years. Through his position in the BEF, he represented Bermuda at many international meetings in many different countries. Mike was also elected as chairman of the Federation CEST International Americas Group, the first time a non-American has ever been elected to that position. Mike represented Bermuda at 15 FEI General Assemblies. And in the end, in 2015, he was presented with the FEI Badge of Honor for his dedicated service by then President Ingmar DeVos. Quite incredible. Mike worked alongside Anne at many local horseshoes and in the show ring of the AG exhibition, where Anne, of course, was the leading organizer for 20 years. As the BEF states, Mike, together with his wife Anne, have been the backbone of the BEF, managing administrative and governance duties, as well as assisting before, during and after BEF events. The Cherry team were often the first to arrive and the last to leave portions. Alka Gibbs, a longtime member of BEF and family friend, shared that Mr. C was a very patient teacher and mentor, always willing to make time to offer guidance and explain BEF matters, sometimes over and over again. He was a great teacher, mentor, friend, and most importantly, a very trusted friend. Keisha Smith, past president of BEF and a family friend also, remembers Mike and Anne as the face of the BEF from when she joined it at age 7. She regarded them as the constant, stable, steady source of the equestrian community. It was Mike who actually persuaded Keisha to join the board. Keisha remembers Mike as a calm soul. He ran the board meetings in the same way, calm and so obviously the expert. When Keisha became president, Mike was always available to help her in any way he could. Mr. C became Papa and Mrs. C became Granny Annie, a true testimony to the warmth and compassion of them both. To add to his many roles and responsibilities, Mike joined the Bermuda Olympic Association in 1992 and was soon asked to be chairperson of the then technical committee. He was elected vice president under John Hoskins in the year 2000, and he served two terms, retiring from vice president in 2008. Mike continued to serve as a member of the now standards committee until a month before his passing, under Chairperson Katora, Board of Crown Chief. Mike was also on the selection committee of the Bermuda Government Sports Awards for 40 plus years, and received the Dedicated Service Award at this year's ceremony, in grateful recognition of his service to the annual sports league. The annual sports awards in 1966, he received a Special Achievement Award in grateful recognition of his distinguished and sustained contribution to the administration and development of squash, swimming, and equestrianism in Bermuda in a voluntary capacity. In 2016, he also received a Sports Citation Award in grateful recognition of his distinguished contribution to the sport of equestrianism as an administrator. I'm exhausted just listening to all of you. During his tenure at BEF and his various positions within the BOA, Mike had the privilege of traveling extensively to attend competitions and meetings worldwide. From the World Equestrian Games in Stockholm in 1990 to the Olympic Games in Barcelona in 92, Atlanta 96, London 2012, and notable events in The Hague 1994, Pan Am Games in Argentina, 95. Mike's presence was felt globally. His travels also took him to destinations as diverse as San Francisco, Kentucky, Jamaica, Puerto Rico, Scotland, Germany, Morocco, Kuala Lumpur, and Qatar, among others. Notably, he served as chef de mission for the Pan Am Games team in Winnipeg in 1999. In addition to his many sporting interests, Mike also invested his energy in other areas. In 1978, with his children both attending Warwick Academy, Mike joined the Board of Governors and served on the fundraising committee for the Pool Project. He spent 8 years on the Warwick Academy Board of Governors, and we know he would have been extremely pleased to know that the celebration of life was taking place here. And our thanks to Warwick Academy and to Mike for making this possible. Family and home were so important to Mike. He thoroughly enjoyed becoming a papa, which he didn't know his granddad, at first to Leslie's daughter Kelsey, followed by the quiet twins, Connor and Katie. A few years later, he was able to relive this experience with the arrival of Dennis and Meredith's son, Ollie, followed by more twin babies, Hayley and April. who was a very involved grandfather and was often seen on the sidelines cheering for grandchildren's numerous activities. Connor's cycling races, Kelsey and Kate's ballet performance and football games, to Ollie's singing contests and baseball games, April's aerial silks and Haley's gymnastic competitions. He and Mama were almost always there. He also found time to return to his roots in the UK. He visited family, toured with Anne, the children and grandchildren, on barges and waterways, staying in rural farmhouses, sampling English beer. A beloved uncle to Nicholas, Andrew and Michelle, his passion for rugby has continued with regular texts and chats between them to debate the merits of England rugby and the Leicester Tigers team. Although Mike was clearly interested in a wide variety of activities and organisations, he made warm connections with many people over the years. He was, however, so deeply committed to home and family life. Some of the family's strong memories of him will always include quietly perusing paper in the garden, industrially piecing together his beloved jigsaw puzzle and train tracks for his model trains, whistling cheerfully in the kitchen while he worked up a full English breakfast for a family gathering. Apparently, Papa's eggs Benedict was the best. Reassuringly, captaining longboats along the canals of the family barge trip in England for many summers. Carefully tended to carrots, onions, and other vegetables grown in Papa's garden. However, Mike never took part in any salads that came from them. Prepping wonderful family roasts and Christmas feasts with Papa's famous Yorkshire pudding and brandy butter for Christmas pudding. And happily seated in his favorite chair, sharing commentary with Dennis on live rugby or Formula One on TV. He really did love his sport, and it was wonderful that he could enjoy them from the comfort of his chair, with Annie and far too many cats at his side, right up to the end. But more than any of Papa's achievements and activities, we will remember him as a genuinely lovely, kind, generous, and good-natured gentleman, always had a smile. He will be dearly missed by all whose lives he touched. So please bear with me for a minute longer. That was beautifully written by the family. And I'll just ask you to think about that last paragraph again. More than any of his achievements and activities, and as I said, those exhausted me just reading, we will always remember him as a genuinely lovely, kind, generous, and good-natured gentleman. He will always have a smile. He will be dearly missed by all whose lives he touched. For me, Mike truly was a lovely man. I don't know too many other men who embody that phrase so well. He was calm, easy to talk to, knowledgeable and friendly. His achievements are incredible. I'm sure many of us didn't know the half of it. But for me, he embodied all that a family man should be. He was involved in the community through his family. He was a true example of a family man. And I thank the family for sharing Mike with us. We are all the better to have known him. Thank you. We've now got a few tributes from those wonderful areas that Mike was involved in. And first, we're going to hear from Ian Shoreham from the Equestrian Club.
Good afternoon, everybody. I thought I was going to stand up here and wing it, but there's no way when you try and recognize what Mr. Terry has achieved that you can stand up here and wing it, because you're going to miss something or you're going to get it wrong. I am going to apologize in advance. There's a few things I'm going to say that John has already highlighted, but I think what you're going to get is a sense of a theme, of the person, of his commitment, of his drive for his family. So first and foremost, to Mrs. Cherry, to Leslie, and Dennis, and all of the Cherry family, please accept my sincerest condolences on behalf of my family, the Equestrian family, and the broader sporting community on this day where we celebrate the life of Michael Cherry, husband, father, grandfather to the Cherry clan, and the leader of various sporting governing bodies here in Bermuda and internationally. My earliest recollections of Mr. Cherry were in the 1980s at swimming events with Leslie and equestrian events with Dennis. I never did ask Mr. Cherry why he devoted such a significant portion of his life to supporting sports in Bermuda, but like many of us, I suspect that it started with family and then it evolved from there. Over a period of time, I too would have started volunteering in equestrian sports, at various sporting events, helping my dad in the ring, where my mom would have been announcing, Mrs. Cherry would have been administrating everything, and Mr. Cherry would organize everything else with a high degree of professionalism and technical proficiency. Many of you would have volunteered in your sport of choice, and I know that on a day like today, Mr. C would not have wanted us just to be a celebration about him. It would have been about all of you as well, because that's just the way he was. Under Mr. Cherry's leadership, I had the privilege of being on the BEF board starting around the year 2000. I was asked by Mr. C to serve as vice president to him in 2005, and I continued in that role with him until 2015. While having asked quite a few people, I do not, and even Mrs. C, I do not have the dates that Mr. Cherry officially joined the Bermuda Equestrian Federation. So we're gonna have to go back in the archives and get that information. However, we know that he was actively involved in various aspects before being appointed president in 1995, the position he held for 20 years. I'd like you just to reflect on that for a few moments. Perspective. I can guarantee you that he spent more than 16 hours a week committing himself to the Equestrian Federation. Because I'm a bit of a nerd at these things. 16 hours a week for 20 years. That's 16,640 hours. That's 2,080 working days. For those that work 8-hour working days, which is the equivalent of 8 years full-time employment. 8 years full-time employment committed to the Bermuda Equestrian Federation. When you add in his involvement of BASA, the BOA, and all of the other sporting bodies that we talk about, I'm sure that he volunteered the equivalent of a quarter of a century in a full-time capacity. Over a quarter of a century. For those that are unaware, the Bermuda Equestrian Federation is part of the global equestrian community and a member of the governing body called the Fédération Équestre Internationale, the FEI for short. The global community is broken up into 8 groups across the globe, and Bermuda is part of Group 4, the Americas. Mr. Cherry represented Bermuda consistently at the FEI during his tenure as president, and one of the many, many significant achievements in his long and illustrious career was being appointed chair of Group 4 in the FEI from 2008 to 2012. Again, perspective. As chair, Mr. Cherry represented Canada, United States, Antigua, Barbados, Bermuda, Cayman Islands, Haiti, Jamaica, Trinidad and Tobago, and the Virgin Islands. Again, please reflect of a significant achievement, evidence of our confidence and support that such a global footprint placed in Mr. Cherry's leadership. In 2015, having attended 15 General Assembly meetings and having served as president for 20 years, Mr. Cherry was presented the FEI Badge of Honor. His dedication and achievements were recognized on the world stage. Thanks to Elka Gibbs, we were able to connect with the FEI and receive the following tribute, amongst many others, but we also received this one from Ingmar DeVos, president of the FEI and member of the International Olympic Committee, the IOC. If you don't mind, I'm going to take a minute and read it. I think but it's touching. Dear family, dear equestrian community of Bermuda, it was with great sadness that I learned of the passing of our good friend, Michael Cherry. As FEI president, I had the honor and privilege of presenting Michael with the FEI Badge of Honor at the 2015 FEI General Assembly in Puerto Rico. Not just for his numerous participations in FEI General Assemblies, but also for his dedication to equestrian sport. But to our personal friendship, which began well before that event in Puerto Rico, dating back to a time when I attended the yearly FEI General Assembly as Secretary General to the Belgian Equestrian Federation, it was at these meetings that delegates acceded by the IOC abbreviation of their countries, which meant that Michael and I were always placed next to each other as representatives of BEL and BER. It did not take long for Michael and me to form a strong and easy friendship, which was not difficult with his warm personality and our shared passion for equestrian sports. Coming from a smaller developing nation and navigating the challenges of an island situated in a remote region of the Atlantic, Michael offered a distinct perspective on FEI initiatives. He often reminded us that certain proposed FEI rules or policies might not be feasible for all regions of the globe. Michael was highly valued by the FEI and his colleagues. He was always approachable with his friendly smile, his interventions at meetings reflecting his knowledge, as well as the respect of those around him. We deeply appreciated his dedication and passion for equestrian sport, as well as his constant support of the FEI. We've lost a good friend and ally, will be deeply missed by our community. On behalf of the FEI and the international equestrian community, I extend our deepest condolences to his wife Anne, his children Leslie and Dennis, and their families, and the equestrian community of Bermuda. Thank you, Ingmar. I can personally confirm that being the leader of a sports governing body is not easy, but it's something that Mr. Cherry managed. They managed it with a steady hand, he managed it with diplomacy, and he managed it with perseverance. There were many changing demands on the BEF for over 20 plus years, both domestically and internationally, often competing with each other and often represented by individuals who are equally passionate about their own particular disciplines. Mr. Cherry always attempted to understand their individual needs, where the challenges were, and how, as a governing body, we could support and help them achieve success. He was extremely technically proficient in navigating complex domestic and international standards so that individual athletes could focus on improving their game and not have to worry about the bureaucracy of the system. He was extremely proud of the achievements here at home, and I'm certain that many of us in this room will either personally or have a friend or family member where Mr. Cherry celebrated their achievements with a presentation of ribbons and trophies. He was equally proud of those competing internationally, attempting to do the best of his ability to support them to achieve their global success at the highest of levels, at the Olympic Games, Pan Am Games, World Equestrian Games, CAC Games, and North American Young Rider competitions. It would be remiss of me not to mention Mrs. Cherry. I am certain that without Mrs. C's commitment to equestrian sports and support of the BEF, Mr. Cherry and the BEF would not have had the many accomplishments that we are here to celebrate today. As a friend, colleague, I wanted to recognize some of the characteristics that Mr. Cherry possessed, help create the legacy that he leaves behind and celebrate today. As John's already said, he's always respectful, no matter what. He was always professional. He was a great leader. He was a wealth of knowledge. He was an ambassador. He was a mentor. He was a great family man. As a friend. In closing, there's a quote that I thought was fitting for today. A horse gallops with his lungs, perseveres with his heart, and wins with his power. I would suggest to you that Mr. Cherry possessed many of these attributes. The horses that we so admire, their strength, their power, and their courage. So to you, Mr. Cherry, to Mr. C, Mike, Papa, we celebrate you.
Thank you, Ian. We next call upon Sean Field Lamont, recently retired from the police force. Obviously very upset about that. And we all admire his blazer. I'm sure he will explain this a little more about that too. Sean.
Good afternoon, all. I was contacted during the week by my dear friend Dennis, who related to SAD. I was surprised and deeply touched that he asked me to say a few things about Mike Cherry's involvement with the Bermuda Police. Mike fortunately wasn't around when we graduated to the new blazer, so I can't blame the blazer for him leaving the police service. You have to excuse me, I did make some notes. I'll try to keep it short. I think we'll all hear the same message over and over again about what a truly wonderful family the Cherries are. And that was down to the parenting of Ann and Mike. I find out a new thing almost every half an hour about Mike and what he did. So to me, he epitomized everything that was good about forward journalism and community sporting activity and developing good citizens through sports. Anyways, so Mike played for the police rugby club team for 9 years, and his pedigree preceded him. When he came over, there was great expectations placed on his shoulders because he played for Wellingbourne Grammar School, which is in Nottingham, which is home of the Tigers and Saints, has a great background in rugby. So when he arrived, the commissioner, the deputy commissioner, one of the reasons why they gave him the job was that he used to play rugby. And back then, I look around the crowd, there's a few gray hairs up there, probably will remember that the police rugby club back in the day was purely policemen. And they played a very good standard, quite violent rugby. And it was sort of an occasion for the other three clubs to even the score, so to speak, on the park. Well, that's what Dennis told me every time he played with. So, but he played a very good standard. He played with legends of the police club, David Love Sr. Some of you are shaking your head, you remember the Lunds, Bill Butterworth, John Williams. These were hardened thugs. And Mike didn't really fit in. He was a gentleman. But he found it hard to break into the first 15. But Mike was very pragmatic about sort of sports, and he wasn't going to let his inability to crack the first team stop him from playing. And for instance, I found out he set up the second 15 leagues, which was kind of embarrassing because I've been involved in Bermuda rugby for 36 years. I was president for 12, I played for the police for 18. And I was completely unaware that Mike was responsible for setting up the second 15 league. If I'd known, I would have given you a bit of a hard time, because it also gave my dad an opportunity to play. And if you thought Lund and Williams were thugs, my dad was a psychopath. So thank you, Mike, for giving my dad an opportunity to express himself. One thing I did find out in my research is that Mike has a plethora of talents. But one of them is actually he's a very good writer. And he left behind a lot of articles and vignettes for the Ex-Police Officers Association. And if you want a little bit more insight into truly what a remarkable gentleman Mike is, take time out and go online, Ex-Police Bermuda, and there's a nice website there. And he's got a few really, really illuminating articles that show what it was like back in the 50s and 60s of the golden era of sort of colonial policing in Bermuda. He's got some fantastic stories. And I noted with envy that he was the youngest sergeant, Sergeant 2. I tried to find his original force numbers, because back in the day you were given force numbers and then we got promoted to sergeant, you were given under 100 numbers. So for him to have Sergeant 2 shows how long ago he was. But he, by all accounts, was a very dedicated, honest, community-based police officer. And he was well regarded within the community. He was put in charge of parish constables, which was, it's kind of interesting, when I was part of the senior leadership team of the police, we started going back to our roots and started talking about reintroducing the parish constable programs. And that was what Mike did so well as a police officer. As a rugby player, he had emigrated from scrum half to center to wing. That's his own words. And I think it was overcoming his physical challenges. He wasn't a big man back in the day. And he came from a school that produced monsters. So one of them, he fondly recalls it, Sir Yarrington or something like that. He ended up playing 5 caps for England at second row. And Mike fondly remembers playing with him because he's the captain of the RAF. And Mike, through his time with the RAF, played for the RAF. And he remembers this game where he was promoted to the first team because of injury, and he thought he was going to sort of get a good hiding and play in the Navy. And the England camp kept winning all the balls, and he was scrum out, and he kept getting crushed. But he was sadly disappointed because this England camp came to Bermuda with the Penguins. And some of the players out there probably remember him. You remember the Penguins coming out. And Mike went up and said to the second row, "Do you remember me, RAF? You know, we went against the Navy." And sadly, he wasn't remembered. But Mike took it in good humor and continued to play very good standard rugby for police. I made some phone calls around the Faded Blues, that's the old for the police club. And to a man, they all were glowing in what they had to say about your father. There was a deep respect for him as a person and a rugby player. He was an honest rugby player and an outstanding leader. His pragmatic approach setting up the second 15 league ensured that the rugby teams of the 80s and the 90s and somewhat the 2000s benefited from the farm system that was developed. Each club had to produce 2 teams, a first team and a second team. And Mike was instrumental in the second team league being played and getting people out there to play and getting the groundswell of youth coming through that ensured that during the 80s and 90s we had outstanding local talent. So that's one of his legacies that I will remember Mike Cherry for. The one thing I do have a little bit of gripe with Mike is that whenever I saw him on the sidelines and down there to watch Dennis, he never let it be known to me that he was a faded blue. He'd always shake his head at me and go, "Ooh, just like your dad." And I didn't know whether to take that as a compliment, but now I do. But he never told me that he played for the Police. And it was only Dennis, after maybe one or two, three Heinekens, he would say, "You know, my dad was captain of the Police team." And I go, "What? How dare you play for Petrus?" You're not the only one. I think it was Billy McNiven's dad played for the Police as well. So, I mean, I don't want to go such a on for too much longer. He, whoever, whatever he touched, he made better. And I mean, that is just an outstanding legacy. I just pause to reflect on that. You know, if we get involved, everyone's goal is to make it better. But Dennis, your dad made it better. And, you know, he was well regarded in the Police ranks. I do have an extra blazer if you want it, Dennis. So that's all I'm really going to say about the man, because I didn't really know him personally. You know, he always said, "Well, Sean, how's your dad?" Things like that. And I was just always amazed at how kind he came across. In a world that is not, that is short of kindness, he had a plethora of them. So, to Anne and Leslie and Dennis, thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to say some kind words about your wonderful dad. He was a remarkable man. And I think the tributes that are being will repeat that message. And it's inspiring to see so many people here from so many different walks of life here to celebrate Mike's life. He was truly remarkable. Anyways, thank you very much. Next, we welcome a gentleman who is the president of the Bermuda Olympic Association. He doesn't have quite as smart a blazer as Sean's, but I'm sure we'll overcome that.
Thanks, John, and thanks to the Cherry family for inviting me to participate in this afternoon. I don't want the blazer, Sean. It's yours for as long as you like. I'd also like to comment on the photos of Connor as a young man. Save those for later and use them at an opportune time. So don't step out of line too soon. On behalf of the Olympic Association, please allow me to express our deep condolences to the family, friends, and colleagues of sport on the passing of our friend, Mike Cherry. In all areas of our Bermuda community, Mike will be terribly missed, but widely and fondly remembered for his vast contributions. It would be a foolish task for me to attempt to enumerate all of Mike's roles just within the Bermuda Olympic Association: Sport Federation Representative, Committee Chair, Chef de Mission, Vice President. The list goes on, and I'm the fool to have started it. Many of my BOA and sport colleagues of a recent vintage knew Mike for his work on the BOA Standards Committee, which has the unenviable task of assessing individual sporting performances across a range of sports with an eye for consistency and fairness. It's appropriate to say that Mike always approached his work with a desire to facilitate each athlete's progression towards their highest potential. This is the same fair-minded approach he also brought to the 42 years that he worked on the annual sports awards, and for which he was recognized earlier this month by the government. As demonstrated by your presence here and all that has already been said and is still to come, this afternoon. Mike was a man who approached his contributions to the BOA, Bermuda Equestrian Federation, and every organization he was involved in over so many decades, with the goal of enhancing all our lives here in Bermuda. We were also fortunate that Mike had, in Anne, an equally passionate partner in this work, and by their example, passed this on to Dennis and Leslie and their own families. We now all count ourselves fortunate to have been around in what might be referred to as the Mike Cherry years, though that's not a small span of time. And I expect that as we continue in the areas where Mike was involved, we will hold close and frequently refer to his guidance, fair consideration, and above all, the willingness to unselfishly contribute to our community. Thank you, Mike.
Now a welcome from another member of the BOA who worked with Mike, I know for a number of years, Brenda Depp.
Good afternoon, everyone. I have been asked to share the sentiments that I felt in terms of working with Mike, as well as the sentiments in terms of our friendship that we developed with Mike, of Mr. Stan Douglas. And Stan was a former Secretary General of the BOA, but unfortunately he's not well and was unable to come today. So we had a little chat about what we thought about our friendship with Mike, and I'd like to share that with you. We were honored to share friendship with Mike over many years, in fact, many decades. And it is through our shared interests of sport and Olympism that we learned a lot about a man. Mike was a true friend. In fact, if you looked up in the dictionary the word friend, you would see his face. He was a true friend. He was loyal, honest, trustworthy, thoughtful, matter of fact, and a good listener. He was Mr. Reliable. You knew without question that he would always be there for you. If he said he was going to do something, he did it. He would give you his considered opinion, with backup and as much as you wanted, if needed. He was a mover and a shaker, and he led with integrity. He would help you work out any problem, and he would help you work out any problem with his logic and his reason, not emotion. He was a fountain of wisdom, and he had wit and charm. I look at these pictures and I see that cheeky, cheeky smile. Okay. And he just had that wit and that charm to go along with it. He was always available to offer his knowledge and his leadership. And he was a great mentor to both Stan and I. He encouraged and guided us without us really even knowing it or feeling it as such. Stan says that they worked together for so long that he could finish his sentence and they could finish each other's own thoughts. Mike, we will miss your knowledge, your professionalism, and most of all, your endearing friendship. And we want to thank Mike's family for sharing him with us for decades.
Thank you. So further, I believe Stan Douglas is here. Stan, if you are. Thank you very much for coming along today. Yes. Thank you. Now we welcome another member of the BOA, who worked closely with Michael on the technical committee. And I've been on a number of committees. That is not one I particularly want to be in. So, the Torah, one of the magic.
Good afternoon, all. On this occasion of Mr. Cherry's celebration of life, it is my distinct honor, on behalf of the Bermuda Olympic Association Standards Committee, to pay tribute to him. And as the sentiments and anecdotes and stories poured in from committee members over the past few decades, and I really did struggle to keep them all to within the hour, I've done that, by the way. The overarching theme was just how loved and revered Mr. Cherry is, and how integral a part he played, not only in the success of our committee, but in the development of every committee member as sports administrators and as people. I will always speak of our ancestors in the present tense, because our roots never actually die. They nourish us, they strengthen us, and they ground us to the life source that we need to get through our days. Although clearly we do not share blood, we are all part of Bermuda's sporting family, and we will be forever grateful to have Mr. C as one of our roots. The immediate sentiment, though, I appreciate, however, is of loss, of missing. When I was named chef de mission for the Paris Olympic team, Mr. C was amongst the first to congratulate me and quipped, "How very fitting to have a French speaker leading the team to France." Well, in French, as with all Latin-based languages, there is a distinct manner of phrasing the concept of missing someone. In English, we say, "We miss you." But in French, we say, "Tu nous manques," which directly translates to, "You are missing from us." The profound sentiment that that phraseology evokes bolsters the knowledge that this person is a vital part of who we are as people, and of the triumphs that we've enjoyed and the progress that we've built, and now that they're missing from us, holding fast to memories, stories, and the lessons learned are some of the ways that we can maintain those connections and ensure that they remain well past our time of pain and grief. And I have so loved hearing these stories and tributes as we moved throughout the day. My personal relationship with Mr. C began when I was a diver trying to qualify for the Athens Olympic Games. That was 20 years ago, by the way. I can't even imagine. The quadrennial began in 2001, and back then the BOA wasn't quite as athlete friendly as it is today. There was very little funding, not much athlete input, or diversity of board members. But as my mother, my coach, and I embarked on the mammoth journey of getting a teenager from tiny Bermuda to qualify for the Olympic Games in a sport where we had no judges, no technical officials, no advocacy, and where nobody had ever seen a Black woman compete, Mr. Michael Cherry was a steadfast beacon of hope. As vice president of the Bermuda Olympic Association during that quadrennial, Mr. C was in constant contact with my mother regarding my training and preparation needs, and it was under his leadership that I was put on the elite athlete list, and some of the financial burden of traveling all over the world for qualifying events was taken off my mother through BOA funding. Mr. C was always caring, always involved, and always engaged in my progress, my achievements, and my career. And for that, I will always be indebted to him. It made me feel really special, but through our committee work, however, I grew to enjoy the fact that he was equally invested in the progress of all of Bermuda's athletes, which is a true testament to his undying devotion to sport on our island and the lasting imprint that he has left on each one of our hearts. A gentleman, a warrior, and a friend. As you've heard, Mr. C served on the Technical Commission, as it was then known, under President Hoskins, and then remained under President Simons through the 2016 Olympic Games in Rio. After the Rio Games, I was appointed chair of the newly renamed Standards Committee, which is truly what we do. For continuity, Mr. Cherry consented to stay on the committee for an additional year, to usher in the new members, including myself. I'm not sure he was completely sold on handing the committee over to a 33-year-old newbie, but as the years rolled on and his one-year commitment turned into an indefinite one, the members of the committee learned, adapted, and grew, and Mr. C grew right along with us. When one is used to doing things a certain way for a long time, it takes an incredible amount of strength of character to admit when things could have been done better, and that change is necessary. And it is through Mr. Cherry's recognition of this phenomenon and willingness to assist the committee with ushering in sweeping changes in funding structure, recognition of performance standards, and documentation of qualification processes that we were able to align ourselves with the region's best practices as we continue to push forward to improve elite athlete support at the BOA. I might be slightly biased as chair of the standards committee, but I will say unapologetically that we are the hardest working committee under the auspices of the BOA. And anyone who has seen the amount of work, dedication, and attention to detail that Mr. Cherry has poured into his committee work over the past couple of decades will appreciate just how much effort being part of this particular committee entails. When we had in-person meetings pre-pandemic, Mr. Cherry would traipse into the monthly meetings at the BOA with the thickest binders you've ever seen in Turkey. He would have printed out the minutes with any errors or omissions noted. Each agenda item carefully highlighted with notations in the margins. Mr. Cherry was always prepared for each meeting, reviewing every document with a critical and thoughtful eye. His knowledge of the current and past policies, practices, and standards was unparalleled. He integrated his depth of knowledge masterfully with the goals of the athlete, the committee, and the BOA in his reflections, feedback, and mentorship. Within the committee, Mr. C was often the voice of reason that garnered a tremendous amount of respect from everyone across the generations who had the privilege of working with him. He was kind and measured in his approach, but make no mistake, he did not suffer fools lightly. He was oftentimes the first committee member to answer an email thread and was quick to point out when he believed there was an attempt to pull the wool over the committee member's eyes. He was gentle with his delivery, but sharp and pointed with his commentary. As the committee was reminiscing over the past week about our time with Mr. Cherry, we had a good giggle at the fact that he was always good for at least one comment when it came to any other business time. I would go around the room, and after we moved to Zoom, go around the screen from member to member, asking if they had any other business to discuss. It didn't matter whether our meeting had lasted 30 minutes or 2 hours. Mr. Cherry would have something to add, and it was never anything frivolous, so we would spend additional time discussing it. I can, however, remember one occasion where we had had an especially long and exhausting meeting, but somehow we all ended up on the same page. And everyone waited with bated breath as I said, "Mr. Cherry, any other business?" And he looked into the Zoom camera, smirked a little, put his hand up and said, "Nothing more from me, Chair." When he passed, I smiled ever so slightly, imagining Mr. C going on to glory, taking the time to put his hand up and said, "Nothing more from me, Chair." Our first meeting without Mr. Cherry is on Tuesday. And none of us know Olympic sport or this committee without him. You will be deeply missed. He is missed already. We will continue to honor his legacy in our work, and we commit to upholding his values, approach, and level of dedication as we move forward as a committee. To Mrs. Cherry, Leslie, Dennis, you are the face of your dad, and goodness, and grandkids. Thank you for sharing your husband, your dad, and granddad with all of us. We know we took up a lot of his time, but I'd like to think that he truly enjoyed the work as he poured so much of himself into it. Mr. Cherry was fiercely proud of his family and bearing witness to Connor's Pan Am Games bronze medal in the cycling time trial last year was an occasion of immense pride for him and indeed a highlight for the entire island. I'm sure you already know this, but to be able to select his own grandson to a Bermuda team where we all got to see Connor shine brought Mr. Cherry an unmatched amount of fulfillment. I am so sorry for the pain that you're enduring. The loss is hard, but I'm going to surmise that you'll never quite lose Mr. C. He lives in each one of you, in each one of us, an everlasting family legacy that he built for you all to cherish and carry on. Beautiful souls leave their enduring stamps on our lives, and how lucky we are if we get to bask in them, even if only for a little while. Finally, I share this sentiment upon the passing of the matriarch of the Horton family, my own grandmother, Dorothea Horton, in 2019. And it's that people live on in our hearts for as long as we remember them. As long as we can hear their laughter in our souls, they have a song that we can sing for the rest of our days. As long as we can see their faces and our memories, there is an exquisite portrait that we can permanently affix to our living room walls. Thank you for your song and your painting, Mr. Cherry. We will keep them in the museums, in our hearts, and we promise to visit them often. To your mom, Mr. Cherry, you are missing from us, but rest well. You earned it. Thank you.
We're going to have a brief interlude while our wonderful quintet play Love Changes Everything. I think the family need a moment to get themselves together while they finish the proceedings with us in a moment. So bear with us, relax for a moment, take in wonderful music from our friends here. Thank you.
Thank you.
A big thanks to the brass quintet, Liam, Callum, Chris, John, and Ken. Thank you. Just give everybody a few moments to get back to their seats. If I could ask everybody to take their seats. So now we're going to hear from the family. Obviously, a difficult time for the family, and a difficult and brave job to stand up and make their own tribute. So first, I'm going to ask Dennis if he would come forward. Then.
Good day, all. Thank you for taking the time to attend our special Father's Celebration of Life. For anyone that knows me, I've never hesitated when being confronted, but today, I'm weakened. So many different groups of friends. As a result, this iconic assembly hall brings back so many memories, most of them great and extremely entertaining. I did get into so much trouble. please don't tell my family, my children. Anyway, guys, family, friends, and sports brought us together today. To all that are here today, and those that are watching on live stream, and to the hundreds, thousands, well-wishers that have sent me notes over the phone and the internet, thank you. My dad was the most patient, caring, and thoughtful person I've ever known. Maybe question where I came from. My parents really gave me a lot of freedom to compete, to travel any school in the world. They showed little emotion when I left and always encouraged me to have my efforts. I'm sure I'm not the child that they planned. Here I am. People did approach my dad on a Monday morning on the streets of Front Street asking if he was Dennis Cherry's son. And my dad, first I asked him, why? Anyway, many rugby tours of Europe to UK, large trips, only one races, horse events attended, were all investments and protected. My wife and children have been awesome. My daughter Haley asked if I was okay. I said yes. She said, it's okay not to be okay. But what a quiet. So, anyway, it's okay not to be okay. All the time. Family, my support team is awesome. Leslie, my sister, I'm your little angel. My mom, I wish I could ignore. My very special wife, Meredith. She's dealt with extremes and emotions and behavior from me. She's always so forgiving and understanding. I've always been emotions suffering. Anyway, here, anyone here that played rugby with me or against me, but no, I never took a step backwards. Even in the boxing ring, this experience my father has rendered me for some time now. It's the hardest experience I've ever had to endure. To everyone here today, thank you. To the huge numbers of friends and family that have reached out from all over the world, thank you. My heart is broken, but it will mend with your love. Thank you.
One of the bravest things I've seen. Thank you, Max. Next, the oldest grandchild, Kelsey.
I'm regretting my decision not to drink some wine. Thank you all for coming out today. It is evident how many people's lives my grandpa touched and how well loved he was by the turnout today. There's too many memories to cover, so I'll keep it short. I was going through a lot of photos along with the rest of the family, and I have to say, well done, Mama, you got yourself a looker. A very handsome young gentleman with an even more charming personality. Also, everyone, please enjoy the slideshow. It took a lot of time for me to make. And there's some golden shots on there. Papa was one of a kind. He had a heart of gold and a soul of gold. He was so selfless, never wanted anyone to go out of his way for him. He had the best sense of humor and some of the weirdest jokes ready for us for when we'd come home from work or school. He never raised his voice except to yell at our dogs, saying, "Oh, you horrible dogs," when they would be naughty. He had a patience of a saint to be able to deal with Mama and Katie's sassy selves. He loved his crosswords, puzzles, and could never miss a rugby match. Don't even try to talk to him when the game is on, because he will turn his hearing aids off. And he'll also pretend they're off when Mama likes to go on in his right ear. Him and Mama have been the best neighbors to have and the best suppliers of Cadbury's chocolate. Mama, you and him have spent an amazing life together, and he had a love story that many only dream of. Some of my favorite memories do come from the barge trips in England, as you can see on a lot of the slides. As some of you may know, I'm a bit directionally challenged. And I will never forget when my grandpa bought me a map of Bermuda, of all places, because I couldn't remember road names for the life of me. And some of you may know, I recently moved to London and Papa made it very well known that he was very impressed that I hadn't got lost yet. But I can confirm, since my move across the pond, I've turned down a few wrong streets, but I always got to where I need to go in the end. Papa was the best. He did so much for community, and there's so many things I wasn't even aware of what he contributed to, as I've seen tonight. He was humble and never one to brag. I'll miss his quick wit, charming sense of humor, amazing cooking, and just having someone to chat to because he was an amazing listener. Papa loves the Olympics, but sadly won't be here this year to witness it. His favorite race was the 1500 meter race. Couldn't tell you why. But when you're watching it this summer, please think of him. I'm very proud to be his granddaughter, and I hope to achieve even a fraction of what he did in his lifetime. Thank you very much for taking the time to come today.
Now the older sibling, Leslie.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks very much for coming to celebrate the wonderful life of my father. Just a side note, very, very good friend of mine, Dan, very kindly agreed to play today. And probably don't know this, but it actually, Love Changes Everything is one of Dad's favorite from Andrew Lloyd Webber. And Ian actually got the, I don't even know what it's called, I'm not musical at all, but the scores, he had to write a new score for everyone who played because it was for the violin. So thank you very much, E, for taking the time to do that. Just put a little bit together. I know we've got lots and lots of memories, so I took a kind of different approach. So here we go. To my dad. As I sat down to write a tribute to you, I found myself surrounded by wonderful memories of you, Dad. Your smile, belly laughs, your wisdom, and your unconditional love, just to name a few. These are the treasures I will hold close to my heart as I navigate each day without your physical presence. You were more than my dad. You are my guiding light, my source of strength, and an endless well of kindness. Your gentle guidance shaped the person I am today, instilling in me values of integrity, perseverance, commitment, and compassion. You welcomed discussions any time of day or night and had the patience of a saint. I think I've heard that like 6 or 7 times. I will remember your smile and the way your eyes sparkled with pride at all of our achievements, big or small, whether it was from Mom, Dennis, your 6 grandchildren, or me. You were my rock, my confidant, and my biggest cheerleader, always believed in me even when I doubted myself. Through good times and bad, you were always there for me no matter what. Beyond your role as a dad, you were a man of integrity and honor. Your actions spoke volumes, teaching me the importance of honesty, humility, and empathy. You taught me the value of hard work and determination. Your love knew no bounds, no limits, and no conditions, encompassing all of those whose lives you touched with your kindness and generosity. Though you may no longer walk beside us, your spirit will live on in the countless lives you touched. Your legacy of love and compassion will continue to inspire me, guide me through the darkest of days, and remind me of the beauty of life. As we bid farewell to you, Dad, I take comfort in knowing that your love will forever be etched in my heart and all our hearts. Though my heart aches and your absence may never fully fade, I will try to find comfort in the memories we share and the lessons you taught me. You are no longer suffering or in pain. Rest peacefully, Dad, knowing that your unconditional love, the support you gave, and the lives you touched will continue to shine brightly in all who knew you. This is actually from my nephew and just sums him up perfectly. If there is a measurement of a life well lived, you achieved it. We promise to take care of Mama and help her through this unbelievable time. Everyone, let us celebrate all Dad's life and the amazing impact he has had on each of us. Let us honor his memory by embracing the values he had dear and by spreading love, kindness, and compassion just as he did. Dad, it is an honor and privilege having been your daughter. With all my love, Leslie.
That was also amazing. And now, the last of the tributes. The more sassy one, Katie.
Hi, everyone. When I happily said I would speak today, I did not anticipate this many beady eyes looking back at me. It was super fun watching all of you come in that door nonstop. Anyway, I digress. I know my grandpa meant a great deal to a lot of you here. So I just appreciate you all being here celebrating his life. Everyone here knew him in some capacity, whether it be from the BOA, the BEF, or the police, just to name a few. But I was lucky enough to know him as my grandpa. Papa. He was there for me from the second I took my first breath to the second he took his last, and all that time in between was nothing short of unconditional love. When I needed my papa, he was there, without question, without hesitation, and always with love. He and my grandma Mama showed up for me in ways that no one else could. They understood me at my core and never once questioned who I was as a person. Maybe sometimes, but it's fine. They loved me no matter what, and let me tell you, I was not an easy kid, as some of you I'm sure have the pleasure of already knowing, but I'm grown now, so it's okay. Despite being a tiny terror and an only child wannabe, Mama and Papa took me head on, and most of the time, all I needed was a trip to Daisyville Drive to fulfill my one child wonder dreams, so that's exactly what I did. As a side note, most of the time I am quite fond of my siblings, but it was definitely touch and go for a while, let me tell you that. For a few years there, Mama would pick me up every Friday and take me to their house where I would impatiently wait for Papa to knock off from work. When the time came, Mama and I would get into their little blue car and drive to the bottom of the hill to collect him from the ferry. Every time I would climb into the back of the car, giggling as I waited for him to open the trunk. And every time he would open that door, I would scream, he would jump. It was a whole production. Unbeknownst to me, he did indeed know I was there every single time. But he committed to the act because he knew how much I loved it. This is just one of the endless childhood memories I have, which is why it's so hard to put this loss into words. But I have to remind myself that without love, there is no feeling of loss, and this loss is heavy because I was lucky enough to know my papa and love him wholeheartedly. Truthfully, I've never felt the full scope of grief until my papa, and for that, I'm both thankful but utterly unprepared. I've always heard people say that grief comes in waves, but it has become a heavy and constant companion that has not left me for even a second since the day he left us. Yet, amidst this overwhelming feeling of grief, I feel now more than ever grateful. Grateful for having known my papa. Oh, man. grateful for having known my papa, for the countless memories we created together, for the love that he spread, and for the wisdom he shared with us. That's one thing about my grandpa that I will forever cherish. He held so much knowledge and wisdom, and he had this incredible power to offer guidance without ever imposing it. He was always gentle in his approach, and I've yet to meet a more patient man. Somehow he always managed to keep his cool amongst the chaos that my family incites to this day, every day. I want everyone here to know that he fought hard every day since his diagnosis. He tried for so long to overcome what his body knew to be true, but he was tired, yet he never stopped smiling. He never stopped showing us what real strength is. And with that, I think there's this notion that grief is simply love with nowhere to go. But I would argue that we can turn what feels like abandoned love to a more expansive love. This is a time to lean on each other, retell the endless stories about him, and use them as a reminder of the tremendous amount of love we all have for him. Papa, to have known you is to have loved you, and the parts of my life where I had you will forever be my favorite. I'm not quite sure how to exist without you, but I know you'd want me to figure it out. I will miss you forever. I'm going to end with a quote by Liz Newman. I don't know what grief will look like tomorrow, but I'll face it. I'll feel it. As your memory washes over me one day at a time, one wave at a time. For such a love, grief is the price of admission, the cost of the human condition. So I'll pay it over and over again until I see you again. The love is worth it. Okay, I'm done.
Thank you, goddaughter. And now, last up, but definitely not least, Ollie.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here. As we gather here today to honor the life of Michael John Cherry, my grandfather, as well as my friend, I'm filled with a profound sense of gratitude for each and every one of you who has come to pay tribute to his memory. Today, we not only celebrate the life of an extraordinary individual, but also express our heartfelt appreciation for those who have contributed to making the celebration of my papa's life truly meaningful. To the Brass Group, Ian Mall, Callum Mall, Christopher Gauntlet, John Johnson, and Ken Hayward, your musical interlude was a beautiful tribute to Michael's love. To those who delivered the eulogy and the tributes, your words painted a vivid portrait of my papa's life, his achievements, and the impact he had on all those who knew him. All of you, your heartfelt expressions of love and admiration were a testament to the depth of character and the lasting legacy that he leaves behind. When life presents you with seemingly insurmountable losses, I find solace in our community, who have come together united to make this process a little bit more manageable for each of us. Vanessa Shorto and Sheila Head, thank you for the wonderful flower arrangements. Lee White for these beautiful trees. Mark Hamilton and Jet Thorne for your kindness for helping ready this beautiful facility. Carol Bromby, thank you for organizing the programs and being by our side throughout the processes. All of you, your presence here today speaks volumes about the impact my papa had on the community. Your kind words and gestures of support are deeply appreciated. Your efforts have helped create a fitting tribute that matches my papa's strong memory and a legacy that will live far, far on. And last, but certainly not least, Jodina from Pierman Funeral Home, PALS doctor, all the doctors at PALS, and the PALS nurse, Roseanne, and Papa's very special caregiver, Aaron. Your professionalism, compassion, and dedication have been a source of comfort and support to my Papa and our family throughout this journey. Aaron went above and beyond to be patient, kind, and personal with my Papa and everyone in the family. He made this uncharted territory so much more manageable and took the time to get my mama to know my mama and Papa and the rest of us. Last night, after Aaron left our house, my mama said to me, "He's really such a nice guy, you know." It's true. Thank you so much, Aaron. Your care and kindness will always be remembered and appreciated. Papa, I'll never forget your cheeky chuckles, unwavering listening ear, and genuine heart for the world and everything that you cared about. Finally, let us carry forward the memories of my Papa, Michael, with us, cherishing the moments we shared and the impact he had on our lives. May his spirit live on in our hearts forever. My papa was a very special person. I hope we all continue to live the rest of our lives with his patience, zeal from life, love and work, and a spirit for what we care about in the world. From the bottom of my heart, thank you, everybody.
Wow, fantastic. Just a couple of housekeeping things. One is, Kelsey asked me to please sign the book, which is at the back desk now. And I'm so glad at the back. If you didn't come in that way or if you missed it, if you could do that, we'd appreciate it. Obviously, the family welcomes you to join together for a drink or some refreshments afterwards. But I think from all of us here, a big thank you to the family and love you, thinking of you in particular. And thank you all so much for coming. Thank you.
Thank you.